such as Ida B. Wells Barnett, A. Philip Randolph, W. E. B. Du Bois, and James Weldon Johnson, author of the Black National Anthem, all managed to prevail. Even in the midst of injustice, they would rise.
Write me down with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness offend you? Why are you beset with gloom? Because I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns with the certainty of tides, just like hope springing high, still I'll rise. Did you want to see me broken? Bowed head, lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened from my soulful cries. Does my hardiness upset you? Don't you take it awful hard? Cause I laugh like I've got diamonds, gold mines, digging in my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your very hatefulness. But still, like air, I'll rise. Does my sexiness offend you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain I rise. I am a black ocean. Leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tides, leaving behind nights of terror and fear. I rise into a daybreak that's wondrously clear. I rise, bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the hope and the dream of the slave. I rise. I rise. I rise.
This would be. Ooh. Don't know much about geography. Did you know that if we had to go through an entire day without using products created by black inventors, it would be virtually impossible? For example, anyone using a folding or a hideaway bed to sleep on would be out of luck because it was patented and was created by African American inventor Sarah Good in the 1800s. You couldn't turn on a light because Louis Latimer was a major pioneer of the electric light bulb. You know? And the only black member of the Thomas Alvin Edison research team that's located right here in Metuchen, New Jersey. You wouldn't be able to comb or brush your hair because the straightening comb was invented by Walter Simmons, an improved version of the brush by Lida Newman, both African Americans. You wouldn't be able to use refrigerators because that was invented by Mr. Frederick Jones, a black man. In fact, you wouldn't be able to use mops, dustpans, ironing boards, clothes dryers, lawn mowers, mechanical egg beaters, striking clocks, fountain pens, and students' pencil sharpeners, or even use an elevator because all were invented by African Americans. Sure, you could drive your car. Yeah, but there would be no traffic lights to help direct traffic because they were invented by a Mr. Garrett Morgan, who, by the way, also invented the gas mask. Something very interesting happened. When Mr. Morgan first marketed his gas mask, orders for the product came in by the dozens, right? But when it was learned that the inventor was a black man, those orders were abruptly canceled. But you know what? What man made for bad, God makes for good. However, in 1916, Morgan made national news when he used his gas mask to aid him in the rescue of 32 men that had been trapped in an underground tunnel explosion. After that, Morgan's companies received requests from fire departments around the country and around the world, wishing to purchase his mask. In fact, it was Morgan's gas mask that the U.S. Army during World War I later refined and used during World War in the trench wars. All y'all that have U.S. History 1 should know that, right? Right. Your homes, you know, your homes wouldn't be secure or even have any heat because it was Marie Brown who invented the home video surveillance security system, while Alice Parker invented a new and improved gas furnace. She keeps you warm at night. Doctors wouldn't be able to use disposable syringes because black inventor Phil Brooks is responsible for them. Disabled patients would have no feeding tubes because Bessie Blount invented them during World War II. In fact, blood banks would be off limits because African-American Dr. Charles Drew was the first person to develop them, while another African-American doctor, Dr. Daniel Hale Williams, became one of the first doctors, black or otherwise, to perform open heart surgery. You know, with time running out for the patient, Dr. Williams made the controversial decision to open a man's chest. Yes, he did. He went into that man's heart. That man had been stabbed during the fight, and in an effort to operate and save his life, this procedure had been shunned for fear of infection. But you know how our mamas taught us how to wash our hands. Not only did Dr. William repair the sac around the man's heart that had been torn by the stabbing, but the patient, Mr. James Cornish, survived the open heart surgery. And he went on to live another 50 years, thanks to his exemplary surgical skills of Dr. Daniel L. Williams. Now you know, these are just small fractions of the accomplishments made by African Americans. So if you didn't know, now you know.
Holla!
Becoming more and more attractive to whites. Many white composers began to use African-American poets in their songs, as well as implement the African-American rhythms and harmonies of blues, spirituals, and jazz into their pieces. Now, the Harlem Renaissance, or the New Negro Movement, saw the emergence of talent such as writers Langston Hughes, Wallace Thurman, Zora Neale Hurston, Claude McKay, and Jesse Fuzard. The Harlem Renaissance was seen by African Americans as overt racial pride that came to represent the ideas of the New Negro. It was the idea of the New Negro that represented intellect and production of literature and art and music that would challenge the pre-existing image and stereotypes of blacks and showcase them in a new light to those outside their race. It was also during this time that the Savoy Ballroom in Harlem, New York began to be a popular hotspot. In 1926, the Savoy Ballroom opened its doors. Now, unlike the Cotton Club, which had a white-only policy, the Savoy Ballroom was integrated and blacks and whites could dance together all night long. It was known in uptown Harlem as the Trap, and in downtown Harlem, the home of Happy Feet. Many dances originated at the Savoy, including the Lindy Hop, the Jitterbug, and the Swing Dance. These dances were influenced by the swing styles of jazz music, and it looked a little something like this.
Baby, baby, it looks like it's gonna hail. Baby, baby, it looks like it's gonna hail. You better come inside, let me teach you how to jive and wheel. Of ale.
gotta jump, jive, then you really gotta jump, jive, then you really gotta jump, jive, then you will, will.
Get Billy, tell her she's on. Yes, Billy, come on now. They're waiting for you. That's all right. Just come on. Sing this song. Be careful now. Oh, Billy.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Them that's not.
That's my belly. Now, in the mid-1950s into the 1960s brought another turning point in the history of the African American with the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement aimed to abolish racial discrimination against African Americans and to restore suffrage in the southern states. This era saw some of the most challenging and painful, yet prideful chapters in the black history, because it is during this time some of the greatest heartaches and some of our greatest heroes were born.
Became Rosa Parks when she married Raymond Parks, a barber who was a member of the NAACP. Now in 1933, with encouragement from her husband, Rosa finished high school. This was a major accomplishment during a time in which less than 7% of blacks ever achieve this task. Despite the Jim Crow laws and discrimination from registrars, Rosa was finally able to register to vote after not one, not two, but three attempts. And in 1940, both she and her husband became members of the Voters League. Rosa took on numerous jobs, including that of a domestic worker, a hospital aide, and a seamstress. It was after working all day at one of these jobs that on December the 1st, 1955, in Montgomery, Alabama, Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat that she was sitting in to make room for a white passenger, which blacks were expected to do. Although there were two prior instances in which passengers Irene Morgan and Sarah Louise Keyes also refused to give up their seats years earlier, it was Rosa Parks' refusal to give up her seat that sparked what is now known as the Montgomery bus boycott. The bus that she was riding on can now be seen at the Henry Ford Museum in Dearborn, Michigan, earning the title Mother of the Modern Day Civil Rights Movement. Rosa Parks had this to say in her autobiography entitled My Story. Miss Rosa Parks.
People always say that I didn't give up my seat because I was tough. But that isn't true. I wasn't tired physically, or at least no more than I usually was at the end of a working day. And I wasn't home. Although people had this image of me being old then, I was only 42. No, the only tired I was tired of giving in. So when that bus driver told me to give up my seat, I said, look, I didn't realize it then, but I wasn't just saying no to giving up my seat to a white passenger. Deep down, I was saying no to the injustice. No to the warped thinking that said that blacks should be treated as less than. No to the attitude of dismissal towards blacks, and no to the notion that would try to convince me that I should consent to being treated this way. Our mistreatment wasn't right, and I was tired. The thought about my mother, my grandparents, how strong they were. And I knew there was a chance that I myself could be mistreated, but an opportunity was being given to me to do what I had asked others. And I knew that I had to sit down in order to stand up for myself and for my people. And although I was mistreated and looked upon as less, I knew I was a child of God and that I was blessed. I believe that all men were equal, despite their skin shape. Though I knew it would not be easy, I was determined to be right. So I stood my ground and I kept my seat, determined to be strong, hoping they'd begin to realize that these laws they made were wrong. Now who would have thought that a simple act from little old me would help to spark a movement that would go down in history? So never take for granted what a simple act may do. Y'all just keep your eyes on God, for he'll always see you.
For decades after the Civil War, blacks in the United States continue to face discrimination, segregation, and stereotypes, especially in the southern states. The 1960s saw the struggle of African Americans to be treated equally and to be afforded their basic civil rights. Blacks soon found out that the concept of equal protection under the law and the 14th Amendment denouncing racial segregation was to the majority just that, a concept and not the reality. Although there were many heroes and martyrs of the 1960s, there was one voice that will forever stand out as the voice of hope for that era, the voice of determination, and the voice of dreams for a brighter future.
This must become true. So let freedom ring. From the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring. From the mighty mountains of New York, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city. We will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thanks God Almighty, we are
free. Shall go,
we'll
go,
we shall go
to see.
To see what the end's gonna be.
The morning,
to see what the end's gonna be.
In the evening,
to see what the end's gonna be.
Night hour,
to see what the end.
How many people here like potato chips? Can I get a show of hands? Oh, nobody eat potato chips? Well, I like potato chips. All right. I see you now. All right. Well, did you know that the potato chip was the product of inventor and chef George Crumb? While working as a chef in 1853, a patron complained that their order of fried potatoes were too thick and too soft. So to teach this patron a lesson, you want to know what Crumb did? He sliced them as thin as he possibly could, and then he fried them until they were thin and crunchy. Petty, y'all, right? Petty. Well, he said they were too soft and thick, so there we go. He then added a heap of salt to top it off, and thus, the potato chip was born. Now, speaking of snack food, interestingly enough, Augustus Jackson, a confectioner from Philadelphia, is responsible for another favorite snack food when in 1832, he invented the recipe for
ice cream.
Oh, that's right, ice cream. All right, we have some ice cream lovers in the house. My favorite is chocolate. If anybody's going for dessert, you can give me some afterwards. Thank you. All right. So did anybody get to see Lion King or Avatar, Star Wars? Did you get to see that in movies? Did you enjoy seeing it in 3D? Well, did you know that African-American inventor Kenneth J. Dunkley is responsible for the three-dimensional, also known as 3D viewing glasses? Now, everyone listen closely, and imagine if you couldn't hear me. Or better yet, imagine if you went to see your favorite performer at a large stadium and you couldn't hear them. Well, singers definitely have something to sing about when it comes to Dr. James E. West, who invented none other than the microphone. That's right. In fact, 90% of microphones used today are based on a prototype of this black inventor. Now, this one is on a more personal note. Have you or a loved one ever suffered from cataracts? Well, did you know that in 1985, Dr. Patricia Bath invented a specialized tool and procedure for the removal of cataracts called the laser phaco probe and procedure? Through this invention, Dr. Bath increased the accuracy as well as the results of cataract surgery, which had previously been performed manually with a mechanical grinder. Can you imagine somebody mechanically grinding on yes. In fact, Dr. Bath is the first African-American female to receive a patent for a medical procedure. Now here's an interesting tidbit for us ladies, so let's listen up. Now we know now everybody's, you know, going natural, you know, I'm one of them. We got people who are still relaxing, there's no judgment. But when we think about the founder of female hair care, the name Madam C.J. Walker comes to mind, right? Well, did you know that before Madam C.J. Walker, there was Annie Malone? Not only did Malone launch her business 4 years before Walker, but C.J. Walker, or Sarah Breedlove as she was known at the time, worked for Malone as a floral agent for her business. Malone took an early interest in hair textures and discovered a way to straighten hair without using soap, goose fat, heavy oils, butter, or bacon grease. And thank God for that, because I can't walk around smelling like bacon. But these were common methods that were used in that day. Combined with the influence from her aunt, as well as herself, and who was an herbal doctor, her knowledge of chemistry, and she came up with a straightening formula called the Great Wonderful Hair Grower. Her product and teaching methods of styling were so successful that she founded Poro College, which was the first educational institution in the United States dedicated to the study and teachings of black cosmetology. Over 75,000 agents graduated from the school, including, you guessed it, Madam C.J. Walker. Malone was a true philanthropist and donated large sums of money to institutions, including Howard University and the Tuskegee Institute. She is considered by many to be the first African-American female millionaires. But she is not the only African-American female to do exceptional things. Did you know that the 2017 movie Hidden Figures is based on the real-life experiences of black female mathematicians Dorothy Vaughan, Mary Jackson, and Katherine Johnson, who are part of the racially segregated West Computing Group at NASA's Langley Research Center in Hampton, Virginia? They dealt firsthand with the flawed Jim Crow laws of the South, and despite being discriminated against, not only as blacks, but as women, they went on to make their mark on America's most respected space and aerospace research program, NASA. Although having to fight hard for the position, Dorothy Vaughan became the first black and one of the only female supervisors at NASA, and headed up a distinct group of black female mathematicians known as the West Group. The West Group proved to be essential to many of the advancements made at NASA. When IBM computers were introduced to NASA, tech-savvy Dorothy moved into the area of electronics and computer programming and became proficient in coding languages such as Fortran. Vaughan retired from NASA in 1971 after 28 years. Determined to be not only a mathematician, but to become an engineer as well, Mary Jackson had to petition the court in Hampton, Virginia to be allowed to attend classes at an all-white and all-male establishment where the classes she needed to advance her career were being held. She had to petition the courts just to go to class. Her persistence paid off, and upon completion of the classes, she was promoted to the office of aerospace engineer. By the time her 34-year career at NASA had ended, she reached the highest level that an engineer could possibly reach. Now, from an early age, Katherine Johnson always possessed a love for numbers. Known as a computer who wore a skirt, Katherine's reputation for accuracy and precision earned her a spot in the all-male flight research team while at NASA. Although facing discrimination from her male counterparts, Katherine refused to let it deter her or the work that she took such pride in, and insisted that she be included on briefings and meetings she felt would be beneficial to her work performance. Her abilities and unparalleled gift for math eventually won her critics over and established her as an integral part of NASA's team. In fact, on his 1962 mission, astronaut John Glenn, America's first man in space, refused to fly unless Katherine first verified the computer's calculations. Not only was she instrumental in Glenn's mission, but she also calculated the trajectory for Apollo 13's first mission to the moon. On November 24, 2015, Katherine Johnson was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom by President Barack Obama. And on May 5, 2016, the Katherine G. Johnson Computational Research Facility was dedicated. Miss Katherine Johnson lived to be 101 years old before the Lord called her home this Monday, February 24th. And though she is gone, it is her legacy that will live on. So if you didn't know, now you know. African Americans with a newfound sense of pride. Dashikis, leather jackets, and afros were a common fixture during this era. And the phrase, "I'm black and I am proud," seemed to be the black man's new anthem. The 1970s also brought a breakthrough for African Americans in the realm of the creative arts. In 1971, poet and author Maya Angelou became the first black woman to direct and make a major Hollywood movie. Actress Diane Carroll became the first African American woman to have the lead role in a television show. And movies such as Shaft and Superfly became popular. In the fall of 1970, there were 19 primetime network series which employed blacks in prominent roles, including Mission Impossible, Mod Squad, Ironside, and The Mary Tyler Moore Show. Broadway was no exception. Musicals like Hurley, which was based on the Ozzie Davis play, Hurley Victorious, and Ain't Misbehavin', which featured all black cast, lit up Broadway, as did the musical based on the Judy Garland classic, The Wizard of Oz. It was called The Wiz. In 1975, The Wiz swept the Tony Awards, winning the Tony for Best Musical, Best Direction, Best Featured Actor and Actress, and Best Original Score, which featured many hit songs, including Ease On Down the Road, Believe in Yourself, and of course, this classic.
My mind's gone. when you lost your mind, and the road you're walking to, don't step behind, but the road you're walking may seem long sometimes. Just keep on stepping, and you'll be just fine.
American musicals such as The Wiz, Hurley, and Ain't Misbehavin' helped pave the way for others of this kind, including Your Arms Are Too Short to Box with God, Once on This Island, and the hit musical Dreamgirls. The 1990s brought success of the arts for African Americans as well. In 1984, the groundbreaking sitcom The Cosby Show made a television debut. It was the first show of its kind in that it depicted an African-American family in a positive light. Within a stable, loving, and witty family, and two intelligent, successful parents at the head. The Cosbys also produced the popular spin-off series, A Different World, which focused primarily on college life at Hillman University, an African-American institution. A feat that had never been promoted or even seen on television. The Cosby Show went on to receive several major honors, including multiple Emmys, Golden Globes, and People's Choice Awards. Who can forget this classic scene from America's Favorite Family?
Good evening. My family and I got together because we felt you might be in need of a little romantic inspiration. Hit it!
I said, From the heroes of yesterday, such as Sojourner Truth, the great abolitionist and woman's right activist, and Booker T. Washington, who started one of the first industrial schools for blacks called the Tuskegee Institute, the Thurgood Marshall.